threshold of a new age where science and technology will revolutionize life as we know it.
We're dealing with grown-ups here. Marshall, you're dead.
If you're the kind of guy you're supposed to be, you wouldn't stick around. That's why they sent you here.
Maybe they made a mistake.
Still, man.
Hello, my fellow YouTubers. I am back yet again with another film review, and today I'm going to be discussing another thriller since it's that month of October and we're almost towards Halloween. I'm going to be discussing the 1981 British science fiction thriller Outland. This is the Warner Brothers Blu-ray. The picture quality on this was pretty good, a much bigger improvement compared to the previous DVD editions. And a lot of people have said that, from what I researched, it was letterboxed. A lot of people have said the film was, the picture quality on the DVD was very grainy. A lot of dirt and artifacts spread throughout the picture. Thankfully, this Blu-ray cleaned it up. For features, there's only a couple things on here. There's a commentary by the director and a trailer. And I like to see this film get a special edition. I think it deserves it. Whether it's Kino Lorber or Scream Factory, it's a very highly enjoyable flick, very underrated. Connery is a great lead in this. He definitely carries the film. You got good direction, you got a solid supporting cast, very nice technical achievements as well. It borrows a couple of plot elements from two notable films, such as High Noon and Alien. High Noon, because it was a Western that starred Gary Cooper, came out in 1952. Dealt with a U.S. Marshal, kind of like how Sean Connery plays a U.S. Marshal as well, except High Noon dealt with more of a, you know, town aspect, but definitely had its elements of, you know, corruption, two hitmen being sent to kill the main character, which is what our character is going through in this film. And in that film, High Noon, I don't think the character receives very little to no help. And then towards the end of Outland, the main character does get some help in the end. And also, originally, this film was going to be set in a Western, but then Peter Hyams changed his mind and set it to outer space, and that's when the film element of Alien comes in because of the company Con-Am 27, and then that company for Alien, Weyland-Yutani, both have the desire to, you know, maximize profit. Both involve, you know, kind of interstellar mining and transport, and basically the workers, employees were expendable, and their safety is pretty much disregarded. It has that element as well. And also interesting enough, a lot of the same, some people from Alien had worked on Outland as well. A couple of notable people like Mountain Bauer, Stuart Rose, and of course the composer Jerry Goldsmith also worked on this film. And to be also fair, even their title sequences in the beginning are pretty similar. And you know what? I'm going to show that, how they both complement each other in some way. Hell, they could even be set in the same universe. So, you know what? Let's roll that footage. Like I said, pretty eerily similar sequences, you know, because of the same crew that worked on Alien. Some of them will work on this film, like I stated before. But it's a great tribute to those people that worked on both of these films. They turned out to be, you know, classic films in my own humble opinion. So there you go. And speaking of which, let's get on with our production crew, starting with the film's director, Peter Hyams. He also wrote the film as well. Before this film, he directed a film called Capricorn 1, which I haven't seen, but I hear is well critically praised. And because of this film, he would go on to do the sequel to 2001, 2010, The Year We Made Contact. And I think it's a very enjoyable sequel. In fact, in my own humble opinion, I think it's even better than the original, so don't judge me on that. But anyways, after that, he did a film called Rain Scared, which I believe is like an action comedy with Gregory Hines. So after that, he would go on to do a film called The Presidio, which also had Sean Connery in it. He also did Narrow Margin. Right after that, he did a film called Stay Tuned with John Ritter, a very underrated comedy. Then the next two films he did with Jean-Claude Van Damme, Time Cop, Sudden Death. He also did The Relic. And then in 99, he did a very underrated Arnold Schwarzenegger film, End of Days, which I have reviewed on this channel. If you want, you can go ahead and check that review out. And in the 2000s, he wasn't quite as successful. He had a bit of rough production history on Sound of Thunder. Then he did a film called Beyond a Reasonable Doubt. And then he did, I think he worked with Jean-Claude Van Damme again on one of the alternate sequels for Universal Soldier. And that's pretty much Hyams' career in a nutshell. He had a really solid, productive film career for sure. And he's been known to be a cinematographer in pretty much almost all his films. Even though Hyams was, you know, a cinematographer for majority of this film, the film credits Stephen Goldblatt as the director of photography. Occasionally, when Hyams needed help on something he couldn't do, Goldblatt would assist him, but he was in fact hired to just stand there and do nothing for pretty much the entire production. And for whatever reason, he would be used as a scapegoat for the new intro vision process that the film was also using at the time. It was a new film projection process that eventually worked, and if it didn't work, they would blame Goldblatt for that. And Goldblatt was really infuriated at being lied to, and if he had known Hyams' intentions at the time and not been misled, he would not have agreed to taking the job. He did learn how to stay to use the introvision process, and he would go on to photograph other films. He did the first two Lethal Weapon films. He did the last two Batman films in the Tim Burton universe. Then he did other notable films like Prince of Tides, Consenting Adults, and The Pelican Brief. So he would have a fairly productive career as well. And if Goldblatt were to quit, it would have ruined his career, and he would not go on to have the career that that he would end up having. So, and then the film's editor is Stuart Bayard. He edited lots of films, anywhere from Superman, Tango and Cash. He edited a lot of action films, Devil Mission Man for one. So he's been a very well-versed editor, and he would go on to direct three films later in his career. Then, of course, the big great aspect about this film is composer Jerry Goldsmith. He did a great job on the score, even though from what I heard, Jerry Goldsmith was not a fan of doing this type of score specifically because it was a hardwired score, and it was only specifically, you know, meant to kind of like enhance the visuals. Goldsmith really liked composing for really just for the characters and, you know, the circumstances and drama that surrounds them. But despite the fact that he's not a fan of it, I really do enjoy the score. And in fact, I do have the complete edition of the score on CD. I don't know if you can find this for cheap. I got this for like under $40, but it's definitely well worth it if you're a great fan of Jerry Goldsmith like I am. Definitely worth purchasing. All right, I'm going to briefly discuss the cast members. First off, we have our main lead, Sean Connery, playing as Marshal William T. O'Neill. We have Peter Boyle as Mark Shepard, the general manager and the main villain of the film. And we have Frances Sternhagen as Dr. Marion Lazarus, eventually befriends O'Neill and comes to help him towards the very end. We have James Skeakin as Sergeant Montone, who is O'Neill's partner and revealed to be part of the drug conspiracy ring that has been formed by Shepard. Then we have Keke Markham, Carol O'Neill, his wife. We have Nicholas Barnes, Paul O'Neill, his son. We have Clark Peters as Sergeant Ballard. We have Stephen Berkoff as Sagan, John Ratzenberger as Tarlo. Yeah, that John Ratzenberger from Cheers. And then we have Eugene Levinsky as Kang. And basically the plot of the summary revolves around Federal Marshal O'Neill, you know, being stationed on the mining colony of the Jupiter moon of Io. He begins to eventually uncover a drug smuggling conspiracy, discovering a particular drug is starting to, you know, affect the certain mine workers, eventually resulting in suicide. He doesn't really get much any help from any of the workers or the authorities. Eventually he becomes himself, you know, a target for murder, and it pretty much becomes a battle for survival from there on out. So I'll definitely focus on the most important aspects of the film, starting with the very beginning. We see that our main character, Federal Marshal William T. O'Neill, is assigned a tour of duty on the titanium ore mining outpost, Con-AM 27, operated by the company referred to as the Con-Algamite. It's on the moon of Io, part of the Jupiter sector. And conditions are very difficult. They're rough. Gravity is 1/6 of that of the Earth's. No breathable atmosphere. Spacesuits are cumbersome with limited air. And shifts are long. And people work very hard. But because of that, they are rewarded with a lot of bonus money. And because of that, they continue to dig for more ore, which makes the general manager, played by Peter Boyle, Shepherd, very happy. And has basically boosted that productivity of this has broken all the records since he basically took over. While that's all fine and dandy and the company's making profits, unfortunately certain deaths kind of get brushed off, starting with Tarlo, who starts experiencing an attack of stimulus psychosis, claims that he starts seeing spiders in his suits, and his co-workers kind of brush that off, but then it starts to get worse, and then he ends up, you know, ripping out the tubing that provides him air, and as a result it kills him by explosive decompression, where basically the blood vessels swell up and his head pretty much explodes.
Sorry, help me get it out, I got over my suit!
Then another later incident happens with Kane, a worker who's pretty much dazed, enters an elevator without a breathable suit, and as the elevator descends downward, when the doors open, we see that there's blood, and we see that his body and his guts, it's a mess, and he dies from that. While this is going on, while O'Neill tries to convince his wife that, you know, it's only going to be a few more months or so, she can't bear the thought of just staying there on that station. So she and her son Paul eventually leave and go on some kind of Jupiter space station to await a shuttle back to Earth. And while this is going on, we see a minor character by the name of Spoda, you know, basically dealing out some kind of drug to a couple mine workers. And then another incident, which O'Neill eventually becomes fully involved with, involves Sagan, who basically takes a prostitute hostage, threatens to kill her with a knife. O'Neill attempts to remedy the situation by calming the man while Montone, his partner and sergeant, you know, sneaks in via the air duct.
3, 2.
Well, he turned. I saw the knife.
But before O'Neill can question Sagan is shot by Montan to pretty much keep him from talking about how Sagan was able to acquire the drug, and this really starts to make O'Neill very suspicious on Montan, and that's when he starts to monitor the situation and he begins to find out more about the whole drug conspiracy ring that's going on. Eventually, Lazarus and O'Neill begin to investigate the situation, and O'Neill eventually is able to get to a place where the bodies are going to be shipped out. and draw some blood from Sagan, and both him and Lazarus deduct that apparently there's some traces of a particular amphetamine drug called polydichloric euthymol, which allows the miners to work continuously for, like, you do 14 hours of good work in 6 hours. And then when they're, you know, when they've been on this stuff for like 10 or 11 months, it starts to fry their brain. They eventually become psychotic and they end up dead, mostly by suicide.
I did good, didn't I? For a wreck?
Yes, you did good.
And eventually, because of all this, O'Neill starts to uncover, you know, a drug distribution ring by the corrupt shepherd, and that's when he starts to encounter or see, he starts to monitor the situation. He starts seeing a couple of his dealers, which are Spoda, and I forgot to mention the actor's name for that. Let me go back down on this. Mark Boyle as Spoda and Richard Hammett as Russell Nario. So by this point, we can definitely conclude that Montone is definitely associated with the drug distribution ring. He's definitely sanctioning it. And eventually O'Neill and Montone eventually have a conversation, you know, during their little tennis court match, where basically Montone's paid to look the other way. And O'Neill eventually concludes that he doesn't really do anything bad, just doesn't do anything good. Eventually, you know, tells Montone to stay out of his way, that he's really just after Shepard. So eventually, while doing more surveillance on Spoda now, he eventually encounters him and chases him down, right down to the cafeteria. That's when they have that brief little fight where O'Neill gets the upper hand. He even shoots at Spoda, especially with the famous quote, says, "Think it over." Very well acted by Sean Connery. Spoda's eventually put in a containment cell. And since they're in space, he has to be in a suit. O'Neill questions him briefly, but Spoda reveals hardly much of anything, tries to deny everything.
Think it over.
Confronts Shepard and what he knows so far. Shepard attempts to bribe O'Neill, saying, if this hero stuff is what you're trying to do, I'll think about it.
If you're looking for money, you're smarter than you look.
You're not. You're a lot dumber.
I'm probably a lot dumber.
That can be very dangerous.
O'Neill once again returns to the jail complex to question Spoda some more, but then he finds out that Spoda's hose has been disconnected, killing him. He eventually goes to Montone's quarters and finds out that he's been garroted, and then O'Neill finds the latest shipment of drugs in a meat locker, and then he is attacked by the other dealer, Russell Yarrow, but O'Neill ends up knocking him out and destroys the shipment of drugs. Then O'Neill confronts Shepard once again, this time revealing that he's destroyed the entire shipment.
Why don't you go home and polish your badge? You're dealing with grown-ups here. You're out of your league, Marshal. You're dead. You hear me?
I hear you.
O'Neill has been preparing himself, monitoring Shepard's communications, and he lies in wait of the shuttle. Him and Lazarus get to know each other a little better. They even at one point, both Lazarus and Connery decide to get drunk. By this point, both Lazarus and O'Neill have formed a friendship, even though Lazarus definitely questioned as to why he is so determined to, you know, expose Shepard and pretty much put his life in danger. There's a nice little well-acted scene between them, you know, him being this, him trying to play a role in this little rotten machine, and he found out that he was supposed to be something he didn't like.
There's a whole machine that works because everybody does what they're supposed to. I found out I was supposed to be something I didn't like. That's what's in the program. That's my rotten little part in the rotten machine.
You want to go get drunk?
Yes.
At least you have some sense left.
And from this point on, Lazarus, you know, offers her full support, despite the fact that eventually the gunmen, you know, arrive. They have O'Neill cornered at one point. Lazarus ends up helping them, pretty much being his only supporter throughout this whole ordeal. She gets to help him out, like he lures one of the hitmen into a corridor where he can adjust the pressure, and eventually the whole thing breaks down, in fact killing him. He lures another hitman into the greenhouse. He drops this panel-looking rectangular object downward. The hitman, not being the smartest guy in the world, shoots at the window and eventually gets sucked out and dies. And at that point, we're all thinking that that's pretty much over. But it turns out, spoilers, if you don't want to, you know, watch this, you can stop right now. Just warning you. Okay, you've been warned. At the tail end, we realize that there is apparently another inside man inside of a Shepherd's drug distribution ring. Turns out that it's in fact Ballard. And both him and O'Neill eventually engage in a bit of a zero gravity fight, with O'Neill gaining the upper hand, disconnecting his hose. And then, when that was going on, believe it or not, Lazarus actually entered into the saloon-like bar. Lazarus is sitting in the bar, kind of observing Shepherd, who's, you know, kind of awaiting, you know, to see if O'Neill has been killed. But instead, O'Neill arrives to confront Shepherd himself.
Oh, fuck it.
I'll just say this about Outland. It's very well acted. You got good actors. You got a few characters that you really want to root for. It's also technically well made from a visual effects standpoint. You have a great score by Jerry Goldsmith. I guess you can say there is definitely some flaws, believe it or not. One of the gripes I have with the film is, honestly, while Peter Boyle, you know, did a good job acting wise, I felt like, looking back, Shepherd wasn't exactly the most intimidating villain. I felt like if he had gotten more involved and threatened, you know, O'Neill's family, I think that could have been, you know, it could have given him a little more weight to the character and really kind of stepped him up as, you know, a kind of more of a more evil and conniving villain than we thought. Like, he could have actually had someone on the inside go after O'Neill's family. That's why I felt like it was like a missed opportunity, I felt, looking back. It's not a disrespect towards Peter Boyle. He did the best job with what the script gave him to do. It was a good, solid performance. He did show that he had some, you know, connections, and that he was pretty much going to eliminate any kind of witnesses or any kind of threats that was going to expose their drug distribution ring. So that's a credit to Peter Boyle's performance and the script itself. I just felt like the script could have taken a little more advantage of the situation. And I did notice there was maybe a few dubs there, like, for example, O'Neill's son was obviously dubbed, but it's kind of weird how it's dubbed with an American voice. It's kind of, I wouldn't say embarrassing, but it's kind of bothersome. You know, both Connery's character is British, and so is his wife, but yet their son is American. I don't know if there was something wrong with the original voice, but I don't understand why his voice needed to be dubbed. I mean, especially during the moment where he's talking to Paul on the monitor. It's supposed to be, you know, kind of like a emotional and somewhat heartbreaking moment. You can kind of feel that with the wife, but not with the son. So looking back, I feel like it could have done a better job in that department. I do feel like that, you know, the way that Peter Hyams decided to hire Stephen Goldblatt and to basically use him as a scapegoat was kind of a shitty thing to do on Hyams' part. That's what I think. And while the effect of the decompression scenes, whenever the miners die, and the and one of the hitman. It's a bit silly, to be honest. It's a very good effect, but I guess at the time they thought if you were exposed to zero atmosphere, your blood vessels will swell up and basically your head would explode. And so, yeah, it's a bit silly looking back. But other than those minor little gripes, the film, like I said before, very well acted. Sean Connery does a great job in carrying the film. Him and Frances Sternhagen really have that good chemistry where it's not exactly romantic because, you know, technically O'Neill is still married, but they develop a kind of a respect and a friendship towards the end where she basically becomes his last hope of being helped. Well, there's a reason why practical visual effects work still holds up, especially if it's models or miniatures, because they were actually built, they were filmed, they were very detailed. A lot of hard work and effort went into building this. And what made this transition even more seamless was through the first time of using a new front projection process system. It was called IntroVision. It was a variation, and going by my notes here, a variation of the front projection process which allowed filmmakers to view a finished composite of live action and plate photography through the camera view on set and in real time. And the benefit of using this was of this compositing in camera was it eliminated a need to wait for photochemical compositing, you know, through, you know, blue screen or optical effects work, you know, to determine if the visual effects shot was going to be successful. And what was great about this is that it allowed an actor or actress or other live action element to be sandwiched, you know, by a projected background and an element all in the same shot. So basically an actor can just walk in any kind of element or environment, and there would usually be a particular background, whether it be a black background or what or whatever. And then it also dealt with a lot of light intensity, and it would have to be at a particular, you know, degree, like a 45 degree angle. I won't go into any more specifics, but you know. No notable films did use this process after this film. I'll go with the ones that I know of. There was one film in particular called Oh God, You Devil. I haven't seen it, but I know it's part of the Oh God series. Believe it or not, Stand By Me also used this process as well. Two of Sylvester Stallone films also used this front projection system, Rambo 3 and Lock Up. Then you also had Driving Miss Daisy that used it, Darkman, Army of Darkness, Under Siege, and The Fugitive. And unfortunately, sadly, by 94, this system actually faded out, mainly because of the introductory to CGI in the digital age. Digital compositing became a lot more easier. Instead of having to, you know, use, you know, different types of backgrounds. But it was a unique and breakthrough in front projection system, which, you know, maximized its potential. And then Outland did a really good job of conveying that, because all of these practical effects shots, you know, when you have models and miniatures and it blends with the backgrounds, it still holds up today, I think. And it's sadly an art that never seems to get used these days. And we are really too over-reliant on CGI. Hey, I just wanted to make a last-minute addition. I wanted to make note of the very excellent set design. The set designer was Philip Harrison. He did a really great job of creating this futuristic but yet, you know, almost realistic bar saloon that we see, you know, later in the film whenever O'Neill is monitoring Shepard and his associates. And then we later see a scene where O'Neill enters the bar, you know, wanting to have a drink. Definitely, you know, took its influence from Alien, while he was also able to create the bar saloon, which definitely, you know, offered a tribute to the Western element of High Noon. And pretty much, you know, the music's playing, you know, the exotic dancer hologram scene, and the people are just staring at O'Neill, wondering if they're looking at a dead man, pretty much. But you know what? I'm going to let this little clip speak for itself on how well executed this scene was.
Thank you.
But another good aspect about this film was, of course, Jerry Goldsmith. He managed to hit on all the right cues, whether it be, you know, elements of the surface of the moon, or the colony itself, or the, you know, particular, you know, tense moments of, you know, the miners dying, or when Connery is engaging in a fight with Spoda, and has a brief little conflict with the other dealer, and also the confrontation between him and Shepard, and also the zero gravity fight scene, which, you know, I think still holds up well. Pretty much all the musical cues, whether it be action based or like the emotional elements, and the like at the very tail end, like the message cue, which you hear, very well done. So overall, you have great acting, you have solid characters, you got some good moments of action, which is low key, but it works effectively. Great visual effects work that still holds up. Like I said, a wonderful score by Jerry Goldsmith. Sadly, he's missed these days. And because of his contribution to the Star Trek scores, you'll probably never hear a guy like that for a good while. But I don't think there's anything else that I can really talk about. But I mean, should you rush out to buy this film? Probably not, but if you're an 80s guy like me, and if you happen to never seen it and you catch it on the television, definitely give it a go. It's definitely worth watching and definitely worth owning. And it's a film in Sean Connery's filmography that should definitely not be overlooked. And it shows that his range of an actor, you know, outside being James Bond or being Dr. Jones' father, shows what a great actor Sean Connery is. And I definitely like the fact that this film definitely respects the two major film influences, which were High Noon and Alien. And I could see this easily taking place in Alien at some point, you know. I could see a couple of these characters from Alien hanging out in the bar. So the visual look of the film still holds up, and I would definitely recommend you watch the film. And I guess that's going to do it for me. Feel free to check out my next upcoming review. Hopefully that will be posted soon. And we will see you later. Bye-bye.
It will shock you.
Put a killer's arm on my body and you didn't tell me.
It will grab you.
That arm can't do anything you don't want it to.
It will scare you to pieces.
I hit my kid. I tried to strangle my wife. I have nightmares every night.
Rated R. Starts Friday, August 2nd at theaters everywhere.